I want to talk about init containers. And I was lucky enough to be on a project last year that had heavy use of init containers as well as other forms of comparable automation for managing things running around your containers. So I thought I would make this short video to give you the basics, give you some good examples and maybe some bad examples and what you can do as an alternate to init containers. All right, first up, let's talk through some basics about what this even is. Any pod spec on any type of deployment or daemon set or any of the other options, anytime you have a pod, this is part of the pod spec. Init containers run in the YAML file, they will be at the same level as containers. They're a different type of container. And the idea behind them is they run first. They run before your real workload runs. And you can have many of them, just like you can have many containers in a pod. When you put things into the YAML as init containers, it will execute them in the order of the YAML. So make sure if you have more than one init container that you put them in the right order in YAML. And the rule of each one of these containers in init containers is that they have to exit successfully. They have to finish. And when they finish doing whatever they're doing, permissions, seeding a database, we'll talk about all that in a minute. But whatever they're doing, when they finish, they have to exit zero. That's no error code. If there's any other exit code, it means an error and the pod will fail. If your pod does fail, then it just sort of follows the standard pod rules depending on how you've set up the restart policy. Yeah. Only after all of them has exited zero, does your containers or, you know, however many containers you have in that pod, that's when those start. So even if just one of those init container fails, your whole pod fails. So these are things that are critical for startup. They're meant to succeed or the pod can't run. I have some examples that I'm going to show you real quick. I put them in a repo. And of course, the documentation has information as well. There's examples. There's a lot of information about init containers actually in there across various pages. I'll put all those links with this as well. All right, and the first one here, let's just look at a cron job. So again, anything that can run a pod can run an init container. And what you'll see here is if I kind of nest these, you'll see that there's containers and init containers underneath the pod spec. Pod spec starts on line 10. We've got init containers and containers underneath it. Doesn't matter which one of these comes first, but it does matter if you have an array of init containers that you put them in the order you want them to run. But in this simple example, all we're doing is a job that runs every 60 minutes as a cron job, and then it goes in and it removes temp files. So we're running the image Alpine, so just running that standard image. Then we're running an rm command essentially in an sh shell. And if that is successful and it exits zero, then we're going to start the actual container. And the container can do whatever it wants. The point here we have is, in this case, we're running just a simple utility command. And that's often what init containers are for, is simple commands, maybe even not full-fledged images, maybe just something that's using simple bash shell commands or whatever, to do some utility type thing before a pod starts. In this case, the job has to start in a script, but that script expects a temp directory to be empty, and we just happen to be bind mounting some temp directory that we're putting in a volume, so that volume needs to be empty every time we run the job, but we want to save things in that volume for some reason. On to number two, and this is Kaneko, a build utility for Kubernetes, allows you to build images. That's not really important, but in this case, we're looking at the init container here, and we're actually cloning a repo. Again, more shell commands. We're adding git into the Alpine standard image, and then we're running a shell command of git clone to download some stuff and do stuff to it, essentially. This is just sort of a regular container. In this case, it needs to build an image, but we're needing to prep the environment. Now, I don't recommend you use this. This is a bad way to use it. This isn't so that you can clone stuff down and change volumes and do stuff that would normally be in an image. If you have an app and it has source files, you want those in the image, right? This isn't a substitute for that. The next example here, we're making a daemon set for KubeRouter, which is an alternate networking provider for Kubernetes. And we have an init container here that sets up the configuration. So it actually takes a config map and it runs a bunch of commands against it. Now, this could always be put in a container with a script and shipped like that. but maybe you don't want that. Maybe you just want to keep this configuration because it's nice and simple. You don't have a lot of fancy script lines. You just want to keep those in the Kubernetes YAML itself. So that's a good reason. And you need this to start and make sure that there is a config whenever you're starting this particular app and the config needs to stay in a volume or a config map or something like that. So you just maybe set this up. Next up is something similar where often we will have seeding situations. So this is just a standard pod. Now you could put this kind of pod in any of the type of deployments you want, but the init container does another git clone. In this case, maybe the scenario is we're running a simple website and we don't want to run custom images. Maybe for some reason we want to change the dynamic and we want to clone an init and then run a standard Nginx web server with that static file stuff. So you could do that without creating a separate image. I'm more of a DevOps-y oriented. I want an artifact with guaranteed file versions. So I want to do that inside an image, but this is an alternative in case you're interested in that. Another one that you'll actually see in the Helm chart of Postgres is where they do commands like changing volume permissions before Postgres starts. So if you were to actually break into that stateful set for the Helm chart for Postgres, you'll sort of see some of this. I've kind of clipped a lot of the stuff out that's not necessary for this demo, but it has an init container that will start first and change permissions inside the volume. We're going to talk in a second about why that maybe there's a better way to do that. But this is how they do it in their chart. And then another one, this is actually Ghost, another blog engine. It's my favorite blog engine. There's an init container in here that goes into the volume to make sure that the permissions, again, are the right ones for how the Ghost container is going to start and need access to all of its files that are in the volume, like user uploads, images, things like that. And so it needs to make sure that that's the right permissions, and it's going to always run that permission check before it runs the main Ghost server. Permissions changes, that's a common problem for me in Kubernetes. I need to automatically change or make sure that the volume permissions are set to the user that's going to run in the container. Well, there's actually probably a better way for that. There's just a standard feature of PodSpec that is fsGroup. It's under security context. And the fsGroup is the group ID you want the permissions and the volume to be set to. And it's got a couple of options. And in fact, in 120, they allowed more features in this particular feature. So you'll want to check out this blog post that talks about Kubernetes 120 new feature of granular control of the permissions and volumes. And whether you use the new features or the existing feature with fsGroups, what it's really doing is just letting Kubernetes go in and manually set the permissions in the volume so that you don't have to write scripts or init containers. So this stuff would avoid any of those init containers that you would need to set permissions. The new features in 120 are mostly around allowing CSIs, the storage drivers in Kubernetes, so that Kubernetes can just say, hey, Kubernetes driver, whatever, you know, NetApp or whatever storage you're using, can you change the permissions instead of me doing it? And because if you have big volumes, like, you know, let's say thousands and tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands of files potentially, changing the permissions on those before the container starts can be a lot of lag. It could take minutes if you have hundreds of thousands or millions of files. They allow storage drivers to use this file change feature to maybe quicken or speed up the ability for it to change all those files before your container starts. One of the things I really like about init containers and why I try to use them rather than entry point scripts is that you can get separate statuses for inits. So if you're starting a container and you want to check status with a git command or a describe command, you can tell that the init container is what's currently running and that the real container hasn't started yet. Where you don't normally get that with an entry point. An entry point script, it looks like the container started, you'd have to go check logs to kind of figure out what's really going on in the container. But with init containers, I can run all these different commands, different things I need to do before the containers start, and I can see which ones have started and stopped, and I can get status, including that the init container had an error. Maybe that's the reason my container didn't start. So all this stuff stores in the status. And now you know. And of course, always show up on Thursdays for my YouTube Lives at 1 o'clock US Eastern. We have guests and we make a podcast. Now you know. Thanks everyone, see you later.